الله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The wife of Al-Walid ibn Uqba, she comes running to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she says, O Messenger of Allah, Al-Walid does not stop beating me. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, tell him that you are under the protection of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some time goes by and she comes back once again. She says, O Messenger of Allah, he continues to beat me. What can I do to stop this situation? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes a piece of his shirt, rips it to a stripe, and he says, take this and tell him that this is from the Messenger of Allah to show that you are under the protection of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and that he should not do this again. She comes a third time to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she says, O Messenger of Allah, he continues to beat me, what can I do? And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam got very angry at that time. And he raises his hands and he says, O Allah, curse this man for he does not cease to disobey the Messenger of Allah. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued to pray against him. My dear brothers and sisters, you can see from this very example that domestic violence is something not something new to our ummah or to our community. It is something that has existed during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and in fact has preceded it as well. But what needs to be addressed, my dear brothers and sisters, is the justification of domestic violence in the name of Islam. So the objective of today's talk is threefold. Number one is how to deal with those verses and those ahadith that seem to be misunderstood. Number two is to address a topic that is often neglected and not spoken about enough. And then number three is to demystify this concept that domestic violence can be justified in the name of Islam. So the first thing I want to address is how to deal with problematic, quote-unquote, problematic verses and ahadith. And that is why as believers, it's very important to develop an approach that is holistic. And this is what I like to call my general approach to Islam. So where this stems off from is you all believe in a God that is merciful, loving, all-knowing, just and wise. Every believer will believe this about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what this necessitates is that the revelation that this God sends will have the same characteristics. That it is merciful, it is wise, it is all-knowing, it is just. Then, the one that receives this revelation, meaning the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will also have these characteristics. Because who does not have these characteristics cannot carry such a revelation, nor be a representative of that God. So we believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he came with in terms of legislation, was merciful, all-knowing, kind, and just. Then based upon that as well, the companions that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam surrounded himself with as a whole and not in specific, must have carried these characteristics as well in those things that they agreed upon. Now, why is it important to have this guideline or this system of belief? Because not every Muslim will have the tools to address every hadith or every ayah of the Quran. So what is your shield to protect yourself from doubts? It is this very system. That I believe in a God that is all-knowing and wise and just and merciful and compassionate. Therefore, He would not allow anything that is against those values to take place. Now with that said, how does this impact you on a practical level? I want you to think about, imagine someone came to you and said, I saw your mother robbing the bank. And you'd be like, what? Robbing the bank? No way. I know my mom. She would never do that. It would be something completely blasphemous to you because of how well you know your mother and how she is not capable of doing that. Now similarly, when attacks come towards our faith, that needs to be our general response. And what I call this response is the act of submission. That once you've submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not allow something to take place that would tarnish this faith as a whole, or would tarnish Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Quran as a whole. It just is not possible. There has to be a misunderstanding and therefore clarification is required. Which now leads me to my second point. That how do you deal with specific incidents of the Quran or specific incidents of the hadith and seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And this is where certain steps are required as well. The first thing you need to do is making sure that whatever you're looking at is actually authentic. We live in a day and age where it's very easy to spread information. And unfortunately, the vast majority of information is not verified. So there has to be a verification process of authentication, particularly when we talk about ahadith, particularly when we talk about history, particularly when we talk about statements and actions of the companions and of our predecessors. They have to be verified. Number two, after it's been verified, is it relevant to our discussion? Is it something that we're actually looking at, or is this something outside the scope of our discussion? Number three, is this the general rule? Does this incident, does this statement, does this action represent the general rule in Islam, or is this the exception to the rule? Because to every rule, there will be an exception. A person can come and say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if you do not find water while you are away in the desert, then you can perform tayammum. Does that mean you take that as a general rule? Not at all. That means that if you're in a similar circumstance, or you are in that circumstance, then that is when you implement that rule. But outside of that, the normative case is that you have to perform wudu. So after you've seen that what the general case scenario is and what the exceptions to the rules are, then you go to step number four, which is what does scholarly tradition say about this incident? The responsibility of scholars in Islam is to convey the correct understandings of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the actions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that, the fifth and last step, when addressing a topic that is very sensitive and something that may be contentious, is look at, is there room for changing of a ruling due to a changing in circumstance? Or what we will call تغير الفتوى بتغير الزمان. The changing of a ruling due to a changing in circumstance. So similarly, like the incident that I mentioned of wudu and tayammum, circumstances change, therefore rulings change as well. So as time goes on, as roles in society change, as society progresses, is there going to be a stagnancy in Islamic law, or is the Sharia actually dynamic and changes from place to place and time to time? And without a shadow of a doubt, it is the latter. The Sharia is very dynamic and does accommodate to all situations and all times. And that is why those claims that Islam is in need of reformation are preposterous. Because when something is dynamic and can accommodate to all of these situations and scenarios, it's not in need of reform. It's in need of a better understanding and a clearer understanding. And that is what the scholars of Islam are responsible for doing. This leads us into our discussion that when you look at the foundation of a marital relationship, what is it meant to revolve around? And this is where I want to break it down to three simple things. Number one, the ayah of the Quran that all of us are familiar with, and perhaps this summer you may have heard it several times, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Ar-Rum, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. That from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He has created from your own selves spouses. And with those spouses, you're meant to live a life of tranquility. And He has placed amongst you love and mercy. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about you finding serenity and tranquility with your spouses. And the foundational emotions in that relationship are ones of love and mercy. So that is the normative case that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to achieve and continue to strive for, even in times of dispute and even in times when things are not good. Number two, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam giving guidelines in terms of how to interact with our spouses. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, رِفْقًا بِالْقَوَارِيرِ, that be very gentle with these fragile vessels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. In the Khutbatul Wida' and Hajj, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us that women are a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that we need to fulfill our trust by taking care of them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ, that the best of you are those that are best to their families. So these are general guidelines that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given us in terms of interacting with our spouses and reminding us that the best of us are those that are best to our spouses and that our spouses are a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then number three, the prohibition of harming and letting harm being done to us. And in fact, this is what we call al-qa'ida al-fiqhiyya al-kulliyya, that this is a principle fiqh that is universal, that la darara wa la dirar, that we do not harm others, nor do we allow others to harm us. It's a universal principle in Islam, in all phases of our lives, but particularly in those phases that are based upon love, mercy, and compassion, like marriage. So now we've seen what the ideal case scenario is, we've seen what the general circumstance is. Now let us look at something else. Let us look at those ahadith where the Prophet ﷺ specifically mentions not to hit women, not to strike women. So the Messenger of Allah ﷺ says, do not strike the female servants of God. Do not hit them, nor should you revile them. And none hits women except the worst of you. None hits women except the worst of you. These are just three examples found in the Sunan of Abi Dawud and Al-Jami' al-Saghir of Imam al-Suyuti. These are just some examples. And you find many, many more examples than this. But you see specific prohibition from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that women should not be hit. A man should not be hitting his wife. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam making it very, very specific that no one strikes women except the worst of you. Except the worst of you. So this is the general basis that we will base our discussion on. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showing us that the normative case is love and mercy. And then we see the prohibition of hitting women. But are there any ahadith that actually talk about companions hitting women? Are there any ahadith that talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even giving a concession that women can be hit? And the answer is yes. And this is where I believe people are truly empowered by knowing tradition. You cannot hide Islamic tradition under the carpet and think, you know what, we're doing Islam a favor by hiding what our books of fiqh, what our books of hadith actually say. True empowerment of Muslims has to be in knowing the Quran and the Sunnah and knowing the context that those incidents happened in. So in the Sunan Abi Dawud again, there is a chapter called the chapter of hitting women. And this chapter has three statements in it. One is a statement of a companion where he says, and this is the first thing in the chapter, where he says that if you fear rebellion from your wife, then abandon her bed. Meaning do not stay in the same bed with her, but rather part ways from her. Meaning that Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah is showing that the normative case is that a woman should not be hit. Number two, he's showing us that you should try to resolve your issues without hitting them. Resolve your issues without hitting them. Going back to the Quranic verse that we will be talking about later on. The second hadith in this chapter is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I mentioned just a little while ago. Do not strike the female slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows the impermissibility of striking women in a general and generic sense. And then this third hadith, this is the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Where after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave this command, do not strike women, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he comes to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he says, O Messenger of Allah, our women have started to rebel. They've started to physically attack us and they've no longer listened to what we say. So Messenger of Allah, give us a concession that we can defend ourselves and give us a concession to strike back. فَرَخَّصَ لَهُ. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him that concession. Now after that was done, the women came back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to his wives. So it wasn't just to him, but now they're, you know, bringing his wives into this problem as well, saying that, look, this is what our men are doing. This is what our men are doing. Now Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah, he concludes this narration by saying, hum laysu bi khiyarikum, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that they are not the best of you. And this is the beauty of the science of hadith, is that once you really study it, you'll see that there are different versions of a hadith that provide different benefits. So when the Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah concludes this hadith, he just presents this version, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, they are not the best amongst you. But you will find the same hadith in the Sahih of Ibn Hibban. And in the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited them again because he saw that this was being abused. He saw that the men were battering the women and this was not something he could stand for. So he prohibited them once again. And that was the seal of it, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concluded with this very point. Now how do we know that is actually true? Because a scholar that came after Abu Dawud by the name of Ad-Darimi, a scholar of a hadith, when he collects these hadith pertaining to women being beaten, what chapter heading did Ad-Darimi give? The chapter heading that Ad-Darimi gives is Babun fi nahi ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi darb an-nisa. Chapter, the prohibition of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hitting women. And that was the conclusion that Ad-Darimi brings as a chapter heading to show the impermissibility of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now still, some people may have a hard time understanding that how could the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have given this concession to Umar and to the men of Medina at that time, that one of the ways to resolve that conflict was to beat their women. And that is a very fair question to ask. But what I ask you to believe in is go back to our foundational principles. That just like you would not believe someone to tarnish the reputation of your mother, فَالنَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is more worthy of a defense than our own mothers. So what do we need to understand in that context? What we need to understand is what was taking place in history at that time. And history will dictate what was considered moral and ethical versus that which was not. And that is why it is so important to understand that. So there was something very consequential that took place in the 18th century. And that was the Industrial Revolution. What the Industrial Revolution did, my dear brothers and sisters, it changed the role of men and women altogether. This concept of gender roles was redefined in the Industrial Revolution. Where prior to this, women are not proactive in seeking education, to now they are proactive in seeking education. Where prior to this, they are not, you know, in the workforce. Where after this, they are now very active in the workforce. And we are living till this day in a post-industrial revolution and modernization of the world, where women are getting more education, where it is becoming normalized, and they are getting jobs that are equal to those of men. Now, why is it important to understand that? The reason why it's important to understand that is because prior to the pre-industrial revolution, or prior to the industrial revolution rather, the de facto ruling was that the man was the head of the household, and there was this concept of collectivism, that there was a hierarchy that needed to be obeyed, and the man was the de facto ruler of the household. But post-industrial revolution, we now have individualism, where each individual is responsible for their own selves, and there's no longer this hierarchy that takes place. And this is why, my brothers and sisters, when you look at this concept alone, you'll understand this concept of how rulings in Islam will change from place to place and time to time. This is such a significant portion of our history that will impact our fiqh and will impact our relationships and will impact our understanding of Islam and gender roles within the framework of Islam. So now, what is the de facto ruling? Pre-industrial revolution. That it is absolutely normal to strike women. What am I going to base this upon? In fact, this quote that I'm bringing you is perhaps one of the most horrendous quotes you will ever come across. Not to show that this is what every man believed, but this is to show you that it was absolutely normal for men to believe this and to preach this, and no one even batted an eyelash. So I present to you what Cherubino de Siena says in instructing men in dealing with crude and shifty wives. He says, and I quote, "But if your wife is of a servile disposition and has a crude and shifty spirit, so that pleasant words have no effect, scold her sharply. Bully her, terrify her, and if this still does not work, take up a stick and beat her soundly, for it is better to punish the body and correct the soul than to damage the soul and spare the body." And this is what he is telling men to do, and no one batted an eyelash twice. So this is to show that this was the norm prior to the Industrial Revolution. In fact, you can look post-industrial revolution, and it is still the norm to a certain degree, just not as vocal. How many of are familiar with Sean Connery? Sean Connery, he was James Bond. He was also in a movie called The Rock. Can't think of what else he was in, but those are the ones that I remember at least. Not too long ago, he did an interview. By not too long ago, I mean like about 15 years ago, not even. He did an interview, and he's talking about it is warranted to strike a woman if she deserves it. If she merits it, then it is normal to strike her. And again, this is live on TV. I can't remember which news station it was on, ABC or NBC or one of these stations, where it's a live interview and he's saying this. And no one reprimanded him, no one said anything, but 20 years down the line when we look at it and we think how horrendous that is. How could someone say this live on air and there's no repercussions of those statements? Well, that was just 20 years ago. How about hundreds of years ago? How about 1,000 years ago? How about 1,400 years ago? Now, I only have 10 minutes left to go. What I want to dive straight into is the main ayah that Islamophobes will use to justify domestic violence in the name of Islam. And those men that are so coward that they can't control their anger, that they justify it in the name of Islam. And that is ayah number 34 in Surah An-Nisa. So surah number 4, ayah number 34. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, men are the caretakers of women, as men have been provisioned by Allah and tasked with supporting them financially. And righteous women are devoutly obedient when alone, protective of what Allah has entrusted them with. And if you sense ill conduct from your women, advise them first. And if they persist, do not share their beds. But if they still persist, then discipline them gently. But if they change their ways, do not be unjust towards them. Surely Allah is the Most High and the All Great. What do we need to understand from this ayah? 4 points. Number one, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam being told to recite الرجال قوامون على النساء, that men are the caretakers of women. Meaning the man's responsibility is to protect his wife, is to take care of his wife. And this is what the ayah starts off with. That in terms of financial care, in terms of physical care, in terms of any harm that can reach her, in terms of even spiritual care, the man is responsible for that. And that is the very first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in this ayah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say that if it reaches a level of nushuz, and this is such an important term to understand, what exactly is a nushuz? The scholars have defined a nushuz as the highest level of rebellion, and the closest example that they give to it is on the verge of adultery. If she has reached that level where she's on the verge of adultery or has committed adultery, then this is what they define as the highest level of rebellion. And this is what a nushuz is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then here are the recommendations for you to follow. I emphasize the recommendations for you to follow. Give them admonition. Give them advice. Remind them of the statements of Allah. Remind them of the statements of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remind them of Jannah. Warn them against Jahannam. That is the very first step. Number two is the term of hajar. Make hajar of them. That leave their beds. What exactly does that mean? They're being told that show them a cold shoulder. That even though you may be in the same room, do not acknowledge their presence. And this is in the level of nushuz. Keep that in mind. This is exactly what is happening. Then in that state, abandon their beds. Show them the cold shoulder. And this will have a psychological ramification. That even when a woman tries to appeal and to put on her charm, a man shows her a cold shoulder. This has a psychological ramification. And that is what this part of the ayah is saying. And then we get to the third part of the ayah, and this is where the contention is. وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ. Literally, you would translate it as strike them. And that is what a lot of the translations have done. But how do we understand this? Traditionally, the scholars of the past, when they commented on this verse, they mentioned four things. That it should be a strike that is not on the face. It should be a strike that does not damage, meaning does not leave any marks, does not break any bones. It is a strike that is symbolic in gesture. And by symbolic in gesture, they say with a miswak or with a folded handkerchief. Now, these three concepts are what the vast majority of traditional scholars have mentioned in terms of strike. But is there another understanding? And the answer is yes, definitely there is another understanding. Where do we find this understanding? Is it a modern day understanding? No, this is from the student of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah, Atta bin Abi Rabah. Atta bin Abi Rabah, he says that this ayah, or this portion of the ayah is, that a man should not hit a woman, but rather should show his anger to her. He should not hit a woman, but rather should show his anger to her. This is what Atta, the student of Ibn Abbas, says. This is the same Atta that quoted from Ibn Abbas that the woman should be symbolically hit with a miswak. Meaning that Atta bin Abi Rabah, he understood that this gesture was not meant to be a real gesture of striking. But the objective behind that is the man shows his anger towards the woman for what she is doing, and therefore she is not to be hit or to be struck. Now, why do I mention this? It is very important for this to be understood, because we live in a day and age where Islam is constantly being attacked. Yet we have to be true to our faith, we have to be true to our tradition. So does that mean that we bend over backwards to appease people? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran that the people will never be happy with us until we follow their way. That even if we were to follow their way, they still wouldn't be happy with us. So true happiness and true contentness and true satisfaction will come in obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he put it so beautifully, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ أَعَزَّنَ اللَّهُ بِالْإِسْلَامِ فَإِذَا ذَهَبْنَا نَبْتَغِي الْعِزَّةَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. That we are a people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave honor, might, dignity and respect through our submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we seek that honor, might and dignity and respect through other than submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliates us. So what we as Muslims need to do as a part of this discussion is not to be apologetic for our faith, but to dig deeper into our tradition and see what our tradition actually says. And the flexibility of our faith and the accommodation of the Sharia to circumstance and to place. And this is how Muslims can stay true to their faith and to their tradition, as well as answer the critiques and criticisms that people will come up with against our faith. So now, what do I want to conclude with? Number one, in issues of domestic violence, a normal recourse is to go to your local imam. I'm here to tell you, your local imam more than likely is not qualified to deal with these issues. Because when you will go to him with these issues, he will advise you with one of two things, on the most part, and I'm being very general here. He will either say, sister, be patient, or he will say, sister, what did you do wrong in order for him to do this to you? Whereas when you look at the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Al-Walid ibn Uqba that I started the talk off with, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not tell her to be patient, nor did he ask her, what did you do to cause him to get angry? So what is the solution over here? The solution here is, number one, don't go to your imam for these sort of issues unless you know that he's qualified. Go to a qualified therapist, a qualified counselor, a qualified psychologist to address these issues. Number two, if you want to get your imam involved and you think he's a great guy, and I'm sure that he is, then my brothers and sisters, invest in your imams. Get them the certifications that they need. Get them the training that they need so that they can address the challenges that you face, and do not give you ad hoc advice that is not beneficial to you and will be further burdensome to them on the Day of Judgment. Number two is that we cannot justify domestic violence in the name of Islam. As you've seen today, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave many prohibitions against the hitting of women. And the ayah that is found in the Quran is, in its sense, contingent to social norms and social understandings. And while the tradition has said one thing, that tradition is when the Muslims are a majority, that tradition is pre-industrial revolution, that tradition is at a time when gender roles are of such a state that the man is the de facto ruler of the household and he is in charge of disciplining his wife and his children. Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, when he talks about al-qawwamuna ala nisa, he says that this is due to the fact that the man is the sole breadwinner in the house, and therefore he is the leader of the household and in charge of disciplining people. So what we understand from that is that if the man is not the sole breadwinner in the house, then this takes him away from one of the conditions of qawwama. This takes him away from fulfilling one of those conditions, and therefore he's not the de facto person to discipline the wife and children anymore. And that becomes a household discussion between the husband and the wife, particularly now that wives are earning as well. And the third and last point, and this conclusion is not, this third point is not from myself, it's actually from a paper that I want to reference at the very end of this talk when I talk about further reading. And for me, it was so beautifully phrased, I could not think of a better conclusion, and that is why I'm just going to read it verbatim. To presume that Western liberalism represents the standard of moral progress to which all other societies must conform is nothing short of a cultural imperialism that ignores and marginalizes the experience of women of other cultures and calls upon them to erase their identities and embrace the superior values of European North American women. Equating progress with westernization and calling for a departure from religious tradition actually undermines the efforts of those women for whom religious identity is a source of empowerment and their greatest tool in rectifying gender oppression and misogyny. That is a quote that needs to resettle in our minds time and time again. That if we keep thinking that everything that the West and liberalism provides to us is definitely much better than Islam, this is a very big problem. Because we need to be critical in addressing these very issues of morality and ethics. Because legislation from Allah, the Quran, the Sunnah, came to address those very topics. And to completely do away with the Quran and the Sunnah, the statements of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and think that everything that the West provides for us is automatically superior, then this is going to be very detrimental to our faith, and we will no longer be able to say that we are principled human beings. Because what the West considers good at one time, give it a bit of time later, and it is no longer good. And what the West considers bad at one time, give it a little bit of time, and it will consider it good in a little bit of time. Because there's no consistency, there is no principles. Whereas as Muslims, we're required to be principles of people accommodating the challenges of our time. Now, where can you do further reading on these issues? I just want to share three articles with you that you can all read. Number one is 5 myths pertaining to Muslim women in Islamic law, published by Yaqeen Institute. Number two, Islamic views on domestic violence by Dalia Mujahid and Sheikh Omar Suleiman, also published by Yaqeen Institute. And the third is called The End of Hitting Women by Sheikh Abdullah Hassan, published by Muslim Matters. My dear brothers and sisters, I had about 30 minutes to present a topic that requires a whole workshop. I will admit at the very end of this that I did not do justice to this topic. But it is a topic that needs to be addressed so that we no longer cease to address these taboo topics in our subject and we create awareness of them and that we don't shame people and blame people for being in these situations, but rather we find it in ourselves to empower them, to help them get out, and to educate people, Muslims and non-Muslims, that we cannot justify domestic violence in the name of Islam. And anyone that tries to do so, their errors should be proven. Our faith is perfect, we believe it, we just need to dig deeper in our tradition to prove it. And I believe that today was a first step in doing that, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Jazakumullahu khairan for your attention. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.